there. I've got the word. We got that word here. Amen. Brothers and sisters, look, as we look around, we see thousands of churches. And we see thousands of so-called ministers and preachers of the word. But when you look hard enough and you listen hard enough, you wonder, what are they teaching in these churches? The thoughts of man is what's being taught in these churches instead of the word of God. And the main reason that is happening is because the protocol has been broken. The protocol has been broken, and you have the students teaching the word of God instead of the chosen priests, the professors, if you will, instead of them doing the teaching. And we're going to start today's lesson in the fourth chapter of the book of John. The Gospel of John is where we're going to start in the fourth chapter, because we need to see that God has a particular order. Okay? And when you get away from God's way, then things go wrong. In fact, they get turned upside down. In today's lesson, we are actually going to see that God chose and set up his priests. And he also taught them everything that he wanted to teach all the rest of the sons of Adam and Eve. So we're going to start at John 4. And if this is a subject that you run into a lot and that you have to deal with people quite a bit on, then I'm suggesting to you that you take some real good notes today, because you're going to come away with a lot of good nuggets today if you don't already have them. John chapter 4, let's start in verse 7. John 4 and verse 7. 4 and 7, go ahead and read.
There cometh a woman of Samaria to draw water.
Mm-hmm.
Jesus saith unto her, give me to drink.
So now, this water, this woman of Samaria comes to the well. Her and Jesus goes into this conversation. And we're not here for that conversation today. But let's skip on down to verse 19, because we need to find out something real important that Jesus said that nobody is paying attention to. Verse 19, my brother, go ahead and read.
The woman saith unto him, sir, I perceive that thou art a prophet.
Uh-huh.
Our fathers worshipped in this mountain, and ye say that in Jerusalem is the place where man ought to worship.
Because the Bible say the word is going to go forth from Jerusalem. And we're going to read that today. But go ahead and read.
Jesus saith unto her,
mm-hmm.
woman, believe me, the hour cometh when ye shall neither in this mountain nor yet at Jerusalem worship the Father.
Go ahead.
You worship, ye know not what.
He told that woman, you don't know what you worship. Just like today, a lot of people don't know what they're worshiping. Go ahead and read.
We know what we worship.
He said, we know what we worship. Why is that?
For salvation is of the Jews.
He said, salvation is of the Jews. In other words, if you're going to find out how to get it, you got to come to Israel, and they have to show you how to get that salvation, because they were chosen, and we're going to see that. So now, let's go to 1 Peter chapter 2. 1 Peter chapter 2. So we're going to see the order, and if you want that salvation, you got to go to these particular people to learn how to get it. And once you get it, then maybe you can show somebody. But you have to get it from them first. And we're going to find out who they are. 1 Peter chapter 2. Let's start at verse 5. 1 Peter 2. Hold on. Yeah, 1 Peter 2. Let me see. Do we want that? Yeah, 1 Peter 2 and 5, my brother. Go ahead and read.
Ye also, as lively stones, are built up a spiritual house,
uh-huh.
and holy priesthood,
mm-hmm.
to offer up spiritual sacrifices,
uh-huh.
acceptable to God by Jesus Christ.
So now Peter's talking to Israel, and he's telling them that they are a holy priesthood, and that they were the ones to offer up spiritual sacrifices, okay? Now skip down to verse 9 and read that.
But ye are a chosen generation,
uh-huh.
a royal priesthood,
uh-huh.
and holy nation.
So he's telling them that Israel is a holy nation. That means everybody in the nation is a priest. Go ahead and read.
A peculiar people,
uh-huh.
that ye should show forth the praises of him who have called you out of darkness into his marvelous light.
And they are the ones chosen to show forth the praises of the true and living God. And as we read today, we'll see that that job was given to nobody else. So now, let's go into Deuteronomy chapter 7. Deuteronomy 7, and we're going to start at the first verse. Deuteronomy 7, and we're going to start at verse 1. A holy nation. A nation of priests. Like I was telling this one brother that I went to go talk to one day, and he had run into some Hebrews, and he was saying that, hey, only Israel is going to be saved. And I said, that's like saying you're going to get this elementary school over here, and you're going to ground up all the teachers in the building. You're going to put them in an auditorium. Let's say you got 30 teachers in there, and you got 500 students. So the teachers going to segregate themselves in the auditorium and keep all that knowledge to themselves? What, how is that profit the students? You know? So if you have a whole nation of priests, they're not supposed to sit in a room with each other and just teach one another when they already know what's going on. They're supposed to go out and teach everybody else. So Deuteronomy 7 and 1, my brother, go ahead and read.
When the Lord thy God shall bring thee into the land whither thou goest to possess it, and have cast out many nations before thee, the Hittites, and the Girgashites, and the Amorites, and the Canaanites, and the Perizzites, and the Hivites, and the Jebusites, seven nations greater and mightier than thou. And when the Lord thy God shall deliver them before thee, thou shalt smite them and utterly destroy them. Thou shalt make no covenant with them, nor show mercy unto them.
Now skip down to verse 5 and continue.
But thus shall ye deal with them. Destroy their altars.
Okay.
And break down their image.
He said, this is how you're going to deal with these people that's in the land. You're going to destroy their altars and break down all of their images. Go ahead and read.
And cut down their groves. And burn their graven images with fire.
In other words, the Lord don't want you to get familiar with any of those gods outside of himself. But over the years and the generations, every time we run up on somebody with a god, we seem to like that god. And we buy into everything that God has them doing as far as their custom goes. People will actually have nervous breakdown if a certain person in their family can't come home for Christmas. And they got songs about it. Please come home for Christmas. Bells will be ringing. Why don't you tell them to come home for Tabernacles? Spend these 7 days with us. Y'all hear what I'm saying? Go ahead and read, brother.
For thou art an holy people unto the Lord thy God.
He said, for thou art an holy people unto the Lord thy God. Go ahead and read.
The Lord thy God hath chosen thee to be a special people unto himself, above all people that are upon the face of the earth.
Now, the people that he's talking to is Israel. There's nobody else on the planet that can say that about themselves. Go ahead and read.
The Lord did not set his love upon you, nor choose you, because you were more in number than any people. For you were the fewest of all people.
Go ahead.
But because the Lord loved you, and because he would keep the oath which he had sworn unto your fathers, hath the Lord brought you out with a mighty hand, and redeemed you out of the house of bondmen from the hand of Pharaoh, king of Egypt.
Go ahead.
Know therefore that the Lord thy God, he is God, the faithful God, which keepeth covenant and mercy with them that love him and keep his commandments to 1,000 generations.
Okay, so now we see that these are chosen people. Let's go to Exodus chapter 19. Because when we read earlier that Peter said that they are a holy nation, he wasn't the first one that said that. Moses said it first. Exodus chapter 19. Now this is when Israel was just coming out of Egypt. And right away, the Lord started dealing with them and pretty much letting them know what he had for them. Exodus chapter 19, and let's pick it up at verse 1, because we see that salvation is of the Jews. We see that Israel is a holy nation, a royal priesthood, and we see that they were chosen by God. Because we heard most of our lives, I know I heard a lot as a child, well, we the chosen people. But like the elder brother boy always say, they never told you what you were chosen to do. They just say we were chosen. And a brother told me that about a week ago. And when I asked him, I said, chosen to do what? And just like I've been told, he didn't know what to say. But I had to show it to him. I was compelled to. I had to. Exodus 19:1. Go ahead and read, brother.
In the third month, when the children of Israel were gone forth out of the land of Egypt,
mm-hmm.
the same day came they into the wilderness of Sinai.
Go ahead.
For they were departed from Rephidim,
mm-hmm.
and were come to the desert of Sinai, and have pitched in the wilderness, and there Israel camped before the mount.
Go ahead.
And Moses went up unto God, and the Lord called unto him out of the mountain, saying, Thus shalt thou say to the house of Jacob, and tell the children of Israel.
Now the house of Jacob and the children of Israel is one and the same. So the Lord told Moses, this is what you're about to tell them. Go ahead and read.
Ye have seen what I did unto the Egyptians,
mm-hmm.
and how I bare you on eagle's wings and brought you unto myself.
Go ahead.
Now therefore, if you will obey my voice indeed and keep my covenant,
mm-hmm.
then ye shall be a peculiar treasure unto me above all people. For all the earth is mine.
Go ahead.
And ye shall be unto me a kingdom of priests.
So he said, and then you're going to be a kingdom of priests. If you're a kingdom of priests, then everybody among you is a chosen priest of God. Go ahead and read.
And then holy nation.
And a holy nation. So if your whole nation is holy, if your whole nation, every one of you a priest, you going to be a priest to yourself? You're supposed to go out and be a priest to everybody else. This is simple. Go ahead and read.
These are the words which thou shalt speak unto the children of Israel.
Go ahead.
And Moses came and called for the elders of the people and laid before their faces all these words which the Lord commanded him.
Now all those words that the Lord commanded him, he gave them to Israel and laid it before the elders. Go ahead and read.
And all the people answered together and said.
Who answered together?
All the people.
Israel went into a covenant with the Lord, y'all. They just broke it. Go ahead and read.
All that the Lord hath spoken,
mm-hmm.
we will do.
Go ahead.
And Moses returned the words of the people unto the Lord.
Okay, so now let's go into Deuteronomy chapter 27. Because the people told the Lord, everything that you say, we're going to do it. That's what they said. Doing it was something else. Deuteronomy 27, and let's pick it up at verse 9. Deuteronomy 27:9. Because we've already read that these people were chosen. We're going to see what they did with that responsibility. Deuteronomy 27:9. Go ahead and read.
And Moses and the priests, the Levites, spake unto all Israel, saying,
mm-hmm.
Take heed and hearken, O Israel. This day thou art become the people of the Lord thy God.
He said, this day, O Israel, thou art become the people of the Lord thy God. Go ahead and read.
Thou shalt therefore obey the voice of the Lord thy God,
uh-huh.
and do his commandments and his statutes, which I command thee this day.
So now these people are the people of God. So now let's go in Isaiah 49, because the people of God has a job. They have a job to do. And let's look at it. Isaiah chapter 49. And we're going to pick it up at verse 5. Isaiah 49. And let's start at verse 5. 49:5. Isaiah 49:5. Go ahead and read.
And now, saith the Lord that mm-hmm. formed me from the womb to be his servant.
So now you got to realize who's talking here. It's not Isaiah talking. Isaiah is the one that's penning it, him and his scribe. But this is Jesus talking. He say, and now saith the Lord that formed me. He's talking about the Father. Go ahead and read.
To bring Jacob again to him.
So Jesus was supposed to get the priests, get them to reboot them, and to get them on their job. He said to bring Jacob again to him. Go ahead and read.
Though Israel be not gathered,
go ahead.
Yet shall I be glorious in the eyes of the Lord.
Go ahead.
And my God shall be my strength.
Go ahead.
And he said, it is a light thing that thou shouldest be my servant. To raise up the tribes of Jacob.
And guess what? It's still a light thing to us that we should raise up Jacob or wake up a brother and tell him he's Israel. It should be real easy because he was born with that thing down in his belly. Because he's the priest. He was born a priest. It should be easy for us to teach somebody who they are. But what else are we to do? Go ahead and read.
And to restore the preserved of Israel.
Go ahead.
I will also give thee for a light to the Gentiles.
So you're also supposed to go out and teach Gentiles and people of other nations as well. not the other way around. Go ahead and read.
That thou mayest be my salvation unto the end of the earth.
That Israel is supposed to be God's salvation to the end of the earth. That means if anybody's on the earth interested in salvation, interested in knowing about Jesus, Israel is supposed to go over there and teach them about that. But let's go and get some more evidence of that. Let's go to Matthew chapter 28. Matthew 28. Israel is supposed to teach the Gentiles. And they're supposed to teach salvation to the ends of the earth. If you don't get it from Israel, you ain't getting it. It's all that simple. Jesus never set foot in Rome. He never gave those people his laws and statutes. But the whole world is chasing after what the Romans put on the table by way of other churches like Baptist churches and Methodist churches and evangelicals. You still Catholic because you have all of their stuff. And you can't find any of it between these scriptures pages. None of it is in there. Matthew 28:19. Go ahead and read.
Go ye therefore and teach all nations.
Now this is Jesus talking. He said, go ye therefore and teach who, brother?
All nations.
That's everybody. This is Israel's job. Go ahead and read.
Baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost.
So now let's go back to Deuteronomy chapter 4. Now that was Jesus talking. I don't see how you can miss that. Jesus was born from the tribe of Judah out of Israel. And all those apostles were Israelites as well. And he told them to go and teach all nations. And y'all pay attention how many times we see all nations and all people today. We're going to see it quite a bit. So now, Deuteronomy 4:1. 4:1. Go ahead and read.
Now therefore hearken, O Israel, unto the statutes and unto the judgments. Which I teach you.
Which I what?
Teach you.
Go ahead.
For to do them, that you may live.
So Israel had to get taught some stuff. Just like when I came in Israel, God, I had to sit down, learn his word. No aspirations, no desire whatsoever to stand up here and teach. Because I walked in the door, and after one sit down, and I realized I was so far behind. I was so far behind and had so much to learn. The urgency was on me to learn as much as I could, as fast as I could, because as I looked around, I saw children that had probably been there all their lives and knew way more than I did, because I just got to the party late as an adult. Y'all hear what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. My thing was I wanted to learn. So right here, it's written, which I teach you. So Israel had to be taught something before they could go out and do some teaching. Go ahead and read.
And go in and possess the land which the Lord God of your fathers giveth you.
Go ahead.
Ye shall not add unto the word.
So now he gave you some instructions here. He said, don't add unto this word. Go ahead.
Which I command you.
Uh-huh.
Neither shall ye diminish aught from it.
And don't take anything from it. And we run into people that do both of them all the time. A brother in my job told me he was a Gentile and an Amite. And then we didn't talk for about 3 days after that. So I slid over to him yesterday. And I saw this video and I just showed it to him. And I say, look, brother, in Genesis 10, it tells you clearly that the Gentiles come from Japheth's children. Then it tells you, and that's Noah's son, Japheth. Then it tells you that he had a son named Ham. So if you come out of Ham, you're a Hamite. So I said, you can't be both, brother. And right when I said that, he was about to fire back. And I say, look, just read Genesis 10, man. And then he was like, okay, don't take my word for it. I mean, wow. But people, and then the other day he gave me so much Paul, man, I didn't know what to do. Good grief. But go ahead and read, brother.
That you may keep the commandments of the Lord, your God, which I command you.
Go ahead.
Your eyes have seen what the Lord did because of Baal-peor.
Now he told Israel, he said, look, your eyes have seen what the Lord did because of Baal-peor. Go ahead and read.
For all the men that follow Baal-peor, the Lord thy God hath destroyed them from among you.
He said the Lord destroyed everybody that followed this false god. And he'll do it to you today. And he's definitely going to do it to you at the end. But go ahead and read.
But ye that did cleave unto the Lord,
he said, but the ones that you did cleave unto the Lord your God, go ahead,
are alive, every one of you this day.
Go ahead.
Behold, I have taught you statutes and judgments.
See, there that word is. He said, behold, I have taught you statutes and judgments. And we're going to see that the Lord didn't teach anybody else these statutes and judgments other than Israel. Go ahead and read.
Even as the Lord my God commanded me,
mm-hmm.
that ye should do so in the land whither ye go to possess it.
Go ahead.
Keep therefore and do them.
He said, keep these statutes and judgments and do them. Go ahead and read.
For this is your wisdom and your understanding.
He said, because that would be your wisdom and your understanding. Go ahead and read.
In the sight of the nations.
In the sight of all the nations. Go ahead.
Which shall hear all these statutes and say,
mm-hmm.
surely this great nation is a wise and understanding people.
It said when these other nations see that you keeping all these statutes and judgments, they also going to see how the Lord is blessing you. And then they're going to say, man, surely these are some wise and understanding people. In fact, David had it written. He said, one that keep the commandments of God have a good understanding. A good understanding have all those that keep the commandments of the Lord. That's the way David wrote something like that in Psalms. But go ahead and read, brother.
For what nation is there so great?
So now, here's the question right here. Start that verse over again, brother. What did it say?
For what nation is there so great?
It said, for what nation is there so great? Go ahead.
Who hath God so nigh unto them?
Who have God so near unto them? Go ahead.
As the Lord our God is in all things that we call upon him for.
They said, what nation is there so great to have the Lord right by them like that? What's the next question, brother? Go ahead and read.
And what nation is there so great,
mm-hmm.
that had statutes and judgment?
What nation is there so great that have statutes and judgment? Go ahead.
So righteous as all this law.
Wait a minute. The law is righteous? Of course it is. Go ahead and read.
Which I said before you this day.
Because right now, the people who everybody think the Lord is so near to, they don't have any laws for you. It's do whatever you want to do. And they call these people the holy folk. But they don't have any righteous laws. Do what you want to, come as you are, everything will be okay as long as you sowing some seed and dropping some money in here. Okay? So know what verse was that? End of 9?
That was the end of verse 8.
Go ahead and read.
Only take heed to thyself,
uh-huh.
and keep thy soul diligently, lest thou forget the things which thine eyes have seen,
mm-hmm.
and lest they depart from thy heart all the days of thy life.
Mm-hmm.
But teach them thy sons and thy sons' sons.
Uh-huh.
Especially the day that thou stoodest before the Lord thy God in Horeb, when the Lord said unto me,
mm-hmm.
gather me the people together, and I will make them hear my words.
So the Lord, he said, especially remember the day that the Lord God had you over there in Horeb. And he said, take heed to yourself and don't forget this stuff. Teach your children. He said, I will make them hear my words. What else?
That they may learn to fear me.
That they may learn to fear me. Go ahead and read.
All the days that they shall live upon the earth.
Uh-huh.
And that they may teach their children.
And that's what we're supposed to do. So now, let's go into Psalm 147. Because we got to answer that question. Because Moses, the way he wrote it here, verse 7 was a question. And verse 8 was a question. For what nation is there so great? And what nation is there so great that got these statutes and judgments? They got the Lord so close to them. Let's see what the answer to that is. Psalm 147. Let's go to the answer to those two questions. Psalm 147. Let's pick it up at verse 19. 147 and verse 19. 147 and 19. Go ahead and read.
He showeth his word unto Jacob.
So it says right here, the Lord showed his word to Jacob. Go ahead and read.
His statutes and his judgments unto Israel.
And again, Jacob and Israel is one and the same. It said he showed his word and his statutes and his judgments to Israel. Now let's see if he gave them to somebody over in Ashkenaz or if he gave it to the people in Vatican City. Go ahead and read.
He had not dealt so with any nation.
It said the Lord have not dealt so with any nation. Go ahead and read.
And as for his judgments.
And as for his judgments.
They have not known them.
They have not known them. Go ahead.
Praise ye the Lord.
So how is it that all these churches set up after what Rome gave? How is that? Jesus never set foot over there in Italy. He didn't talk to him. And when it was time to talk to an Italian, he had Cornelius, that Italian, to go and get Peter and say, Israel gonna tell you what to do. You can go read that in Acts 10. So now, let's go into Romans 9. The Lord never gave his statutes and judgments to anybody. In fact, if you go in Acts 7, it said when Stephen was talking, he said Moses and Israel received the lively oracles back there in the wilderness to give to us. So whatever the Lord gave Israel when they came out the wilderness was good in Acts chapter 7, which was after the death of Jesus. And then Paul told you in Romans 3 that Israel were the only ones that got the oracles of God, which are his answers. So if you want the answers, you got to come to us. Even though we shine in your shoes and mopping your floors, you still got to come over here and get this information from us. It's all that simple. So now, Romans 9, my brother. Romans 9, and let's pick it up at the first verse, Romans 9 and 1. Let's see if Paul agrees with David. 9 and 1, go ahead and read.
I say the truth in Christ. I lie not, my conscience also bearing me witness in the Holy Ghost, that I have great heaviness and continual sorrow in my heart.
So Paul said he got this great heaviness in his heart, a continual sorrow. Go ahead and read.
For I could wish that myself were accursed from Christ for my brethren.
So Paul is clearly saying his brethren has a curse dropped on him, and he wished the Lord would have just put it on him individually. That's one powerful wish, is it not? He said, I wish that the Lord would just put it on me instead of my brethren. Go ahead and read.
My kinsmen. According to the flesh.
Go ahead and read.
Who are Israelites? To whom pertaineth the adoption?
So it says, my kinsmen got this curse put on them. They are Israelites. And he said, by the way, to whom pertained the adoption? Because the Lord adopted their father Jacob. Go ahead and read.
And the glory.
And the glory. They have the glory of the Lord with them. Go ahead and read.
And the covenant.
And the Lord made a covenant with the forefathers of Israel. Go ahead.
And the giving of the law.
And the giving of the law is Israel's job. Nobody else's. Go ahead and read.
And the service of God.
And the service of God belong to Israel. Go ahead.
And the promise.
And the promises was made to them. Who else on the planet can say that? Can Japan say that? What about Russia? Mm-mm. What about Greece?
Nope.
Nobody can say that but Israel. So if you want to get taught the word, whether you like it or not, that's who you have to go to. Go ahead and read.
Whose are the fathers?
Whose are the fathers?
And of whom, as concerning the flesh, Christ came.
So Christ came through these people. He had to because he chose them to be his priests. Why would he come through anybody else? Go ahead and read.
Who is over all? God bless forever. Amen.
Yes, sir. So now let's go into Matthew chapter 5. Because the title of this lesson is Israel, the Salt of the Earth. Matthew chapter 5, because the earth got to be seasoned by the priest. Season them with that word. Matthew chapter 5, let's pick it up at verse 9. 5 and 9. Back to Jesus here. 5 and 9, go ahead and read.
Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God.
Go ahead.
Blessed are they which are persecuted for righteousness' sake.
It says, blessed are they which are persecuted for righteousness' sake. Why is that, brother?
For theirs is the kingdom of heaven.
So, by the way, if you're doing the right things and you're being persecuted, don't get weary, don't get tired. Just keep on doing the right thing. Go ahead and read.
Blessed are ye when men shall revile you and persecute you and shall say all manner of evil against you falsely.
Go ahead.
For my sake.
Go ahead.
Rejoice and be exceeding glad, for great is your reward in heaven. For so persecuted they the prophets which were before you. Ye are the salt of the earth.
You are what?
The salt of the earth.
Now Jesus is talking to Israel and he's telling them, you are the salt of the earth. Because we read earlier, didn't he tell him to go teach all nations? Salt does a lot of things. Salt preserves. It adds flavor, does it not? What other characteristics does salt have? Anybody? What else can salt do? It saves. Huh? So you can give people words that can preserve them. You can give people words that can save them. So you going out here with this word, and we actually have to season this earth with the word of God. That's our job. Because we're going to see earlier that some meats, if you cook it or try to eat it without salt, it's bland. Ain't no flavor to it. We have to add flavor to every nation under the sun, y'all. That's our job, by teaching them this word of God. But go ahead and read, brother.
But if the salt have lost its savor.
He said, however, but if the salt have lost its savor, go ahead.
Wherewith shall it be salted?
Go ahead.
It is thenceforth good for nothing.
So now if the chosen priests are not going out teaching that word, what good is he? Huh? If you're not going to handle this word of God right and do what the Lord chose us to do, then what good are you? He says you are good for nothing. Go ahead and read.
But to be cast out.
But to be cast out.
And to be trodden under foot of men.
And y'all know that happened to us. Go ahead and read.
Ye are the light of the world.
It says, not only are you the salt of the earth, you are the light of the world. Go ahead and read.
A city that is set on a hill cannot be hid.
A city that is set on a hill cannot be hid. That's why when we go into our jobs, we want to shut up about the word. Huh? We want to shut up, but can we really? We got to say something to somebody. Because we are light up on a hill. You can't hide us. If the Lord stick us in there, we got to say something to somebody, because that's our job. And we're supposed to do it willingly. We're not supposed to have somebody behind us pushing us out there. We're supposed to willingly teach the gospel. Because we are the chosen priests. We were born with that job. You can go get the youngest baby in there. That baby is a priest of God in that room right there. Y'all hear what I'm saying? So now, we are the light of the world and we are the salt of the earth. But if a salt has lost its savor, it's good for nothing. Why would you put some salt on your food and it's not salty? Huh? Now, let's go ahead. Let's move on. Let's go to Isaiah chapter 2. Isaiah chapter 2, we're going to see earlier, I mean later on, that Israel lost its saltiness. Okay? Isaiah chapter 2. And we are getting the results of it in this generation. Isaiah chapter 2. Isaiah chapter 2, and we're going to start at that first verse. Isaiah 2 and verse 1. 2 and 1. Go ahead and read it, brother.
The word that Isaiah, the son of Amos, saw concerning Judah and Jerusalem.
Concerning Judah and Jerusalem. Go ahead.
And it shall come to pass in the last days that the mountain of the Lord's house shall be established in the top of the mountain.
So now, when is this going to happen?
In the last days, right?
In the last days, it said the Lord's house is going to be established in the top of the mountains. Go ahead and read.
And shall be exalted above the hills.
It shall be exalted above the hills. Go ahead.
And all nations shall flow unto it.
Who going to flow to it?
All nations.
All nations going to flow to the Lord's hill. Go ahead and read.
And many people shall go and say, come ye. And let us go up to the mountain of the Lord, to the house of the God of Jacob.
It says to the house of the Lord, to the house of the God of Jacob. Go ahead.
And he will teach us of his ways.
He will do what?
Teach us.
But he taught his priests too when they came out of Egypt. But this is in the last days. He will teach us of his ways. Go ahead and read.
And we will walk in his path. For out of Zion shall go forth the law. And the word of the Lord. From Jerusalem.
Wait a minute. You mean in the last days the law still going to be going forth? But they telling you today ain't no law. How is there was a law in Moses' days? And there was a law that Jesus talked about. And now we talking about in the last days when he come back and establish his mountain, his government, that the law is going to go forth. And then we see it's going to go forth from Jerusalem. Is it going to go forth from Rome, y'all? It's going to go forth from Jerusalem. So now, let's press on. Let's go to 1 Kings chapter 10. And let's look at an example of that. 1 Kings chapter 10. The word of the Lord go forth from Jerusalem. Nowhere else. not Sydney, Australia, not Tokyo, Japan. Yes, sir. Chapter 10. 1 Kings 10. The word of the Lord go forth from Jerusalem, because you have to go to the priest to get it. And being that the whole nation is a holy nation and it's a kingdom of priests, you should be able to turn to any brother that's an Israelite and ask him a Bible question. And they're supposed to have an answer for you. And let's look at an example of that. 1 Kings 10 and 1. Go ahead and read, brother.
And when the queen of Sheba heard of the fame of Solomon.
The queen of who?
Sheba.
Did that say Ethiopia? Mm-mm. So where we get all this stuff from? About Solomon and the queen of Sheba, who's from Ethiopia. Is she the queen of Sheba? She from Sheba. Y'all see what I'm saying? It's like saying the king of Germany is French. No, if he's the king of Germany, he's in Germany. If she's the queen of Sheba, she's from Sheba. That's not Ethiopia. So for the people with all this stuff about Selassie and all these other people, forget about it. Go ahead and read.
Heard of the fame of Solomon concerning the name of the Lord.
Concerning what?
The name of the Lord.
Go ahead and read.
She came to prove him with hard questions.
Yes.
And she came to Jerusalem with a very great train.
Go ahead.
With camels that bear spices and very much gold and precious stones. And when she was come to Solomon, she communed with him of all that was in her heart.
That means she talked with him. Sisters and brothers, commune means you communicated. Ain't nothing holy about that. You can communicate and cuss somebody out. What's holy about that kind of communing with somebody? But they've made everything that ain't holy, holy. And then they got the stuff that's holy. And all, you ain't got to deal with that no more. But go ahead and read, brother.
And Solomon told her all her questions.
Mm-hmm.
There was not anything hid from the king, which he told her not.
Go ahead.
And when the queen of Sheba had seen all Solomon's wisdom and the house that he had built.
Go ahead.
And the meat of his table and the sitting of his servants and the attendance of his ministers.
Now she's really observing. She's taking a look. It said when she saw his wisdom, she saw that house that he built. She saw the meat at his table, his servants. And everything else, all the people that's ministers and everything. Go ahead and read.
And their apparel and his cupbearer and his ascent by which he went up into the house of the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
There was no more spirit in her.
It's almost like she almost passed out. Go ahead and read.
And she said to the king,
It
was a true report that I heard in mine own land of thy acts and of thy wisdom.
She said it was a true report that I heard in my own land of all your acts and of all your wisdom. Just like the same way it should be a rumor around Baton Rouge. If y'all want the real word of God, the true word of God, go over there at 1821 Wooddale Court. You know what I'm saying? That word should be out there. And I hear people that come over here and say, hey, man, my brother told me to come over here. But they get here and then they'll hear something or see something that they disagree with. And then they don't come back. But hey, that's on them, because all we do is read the book. But go ahead and read, brother.
Howbeit, I believed not the words until I came, and mine eyes had seen it. And behold, the half was not told me. Thy wisdom and prosperity exceeded the fame which I heard.
Go ahead.
Happy are thy men.
She said, your men are happy.
Happy are these thy servants, which stand continually before thee, and that hear thy wisdom.
Go ahead.
Blessed be the Lord thy God, which delighteth in thee to set thee on the throne of Israel, because the Lord loved Israel forever.
Mm-hmm.
Therefore made he thee king to do judgment and justice.
Go ahead.
And she gave the king 120 talents of gold.
So now she starts giving him stuff. Go ahead.
And of spices, very great store. And precious stones. There came no more such abundance of spices as these which the queen of Sheba gave to King Solomon.
So now we see that he was wise in the word of God, and he answered every question that woman had concerning the word of God, which is something that we all supposed to do. But King Solomon sat on the throne in Jerusalem. And it says when Jesus come back, he's going to establish his there. The book tells us he's going to sit on David's throne in Jerusalem. He ain't going to Vatican City. He's not going to Rome. He never went there when he was here, and he ain't going to be there when he come back. The word going to go forth from Jerusalem. Those are the people that he gave the word to. He didn't give it to Papa. But that's who everybody's getting their word from. That's why they're going to be in church tomorrow. The book never said church on Sunday. Ever. But everybody's in there. So now, let's move on. Let's go to Job chapter 6. Because Israel was the ones chosen to be the salt of the earth, to go out there and to season, or should I say, teach all nations the true word of God. But they went out there as the chosen priests, the ones chosen to teach the true word, and all the falsehoods they saw, they just bought into it. They bought clean into it. When they know, deer can't fly. You know a 400-pound dude is not about to come down your fireplace, man. But Israel bought that stuff. Job chapter 6, my brother. You're supposed to be the salt. Job 6, verse 6. Go ahead and read.
Can that which is unsavory be eaten without salt?
He said, look at this question Job asked. Can that which is unsavory be eaten without salt? Can it? Go ahead and read.
Or is there any taste in the white of an egg?
Is there any taste in the white of an egg? No, there's not. You're going to want to put some salt on them egg whites. Just like the world need Israel to come teach them this true word of God. That's our job. Go ahead and read, brother.
The things that my soul refuses to touch are as my sorrowful meat.
And sorrowful meat is what we would leave the world if we don't get on out there and teach them this true gospel. If we let them keep believing that they're supposed to sit up in church tomorrow. If we let them keep believing that jingle bells all the way is what you're supposed to be doing. That is not what you're supposed to do because you can't read it in this book. But the word was given to us. Our ancestors didn't go out there and teach it. And we're getting punished for it. Meanwhile, the world has been following behind people who did not get the word of God, who didn't get the laws and the judgments and the statutes. And now everything is upside down. All you hear is corruption. All you hear is murder. All you hear about is theft and rape and blackmail. Somebody went up in a school yesterday and shot it up in California. Huh? So that's the world we live in because we didn't do our job. Our ancestors didn't do it, and a lot of us don't want to do it today. We have bought so-called religion from this people who we were supposed to teach it to. So shame on us. So now, Leviticus chapter 2. Leviticus 2, and let's go into verse 8. Leviticus chapter 2, we're going to start at verse 8. 2 and 8. So we're getting just what we're supposed to get. Because our speech was supposed to be with salt. And we were supposed to go out there willingly and teach the true word of God. But we chose not to. Leviticus chapter 2, verse 8. My brother, go ahead and read.
And thou shalt bring the meat offering that is made of these things unto the Lord.
So now the Lord is giving Israel instructions on how they are supposed to do their sacrifices and offerings. Go ahead and read.
And when it is presented unto the priest, he shall bring it unto the altar.
Go ahead.
And the priest shall take from the meat offering a memorial thereof.
Uh-huh.
And shall burn it upon the altar.
Mm-hmm.
It is an offering made by fire of a sweet savor unto the Lord.
Go ahead.
And that which is left of the meat offering.
He said, and whatever's left of that meat offering, go ahead.
Shall be Aaron's and his sons.
So Aaron and his sons, who's handling the office of the priest, they get what's left. Go ahead.
It is a thing most holy of the offerings of the Lord made by fire.
Now skip on down to verse 13 and read that. Verse 13, go ahead and read.
And every oblation of thy meat offering shalt thou season with salt.
Wait a minute. How many are the oblations?
Every.
He say every one of your sacrifices, your offerings, should be seasoned with salt. Go ahead and read.
Thou see, neither shalt thou suffer the salt of the covenant of thy God to be lacking.
He said, don't even lack on the amount of salt you put on it. Go ahead and read.
With all thine offerings, thou shalt offer salt.
Yes.
And if
That's good. So the Lord is telling Israel, with all of your offering, you're going to offer salt with that meat offering, okay? So now, let's go into Mark chapter 9. Mark chapter 9. The Lord did a lot of things physically to show you something spiritually. He's showing you got you doing something physically, but it has a spiritual meaning to it. He said, don't lack on that salt. Mark chapter 9, let's start at verse 47. 9 and 47. Let's go back to Jesus. Mark 9 and 47. 9 and 47. Go ahead and read.
And if thine eye offend thee, pluck it out.
Mm-hmm.
It is better for thee to enter into the kingdom of God with one eye than having two eyes to be cast into hell fire.
Go ahead and read.
Where their worm died not, and the fire is not quenched.
So Jesus is saying, hey, it's better that if your eye offends you, pluck it out. Because if you end up in that fire, lake of fire, the worm don't die, and the fire does not get quenched. Go ahead and read.
For everyone shall be salted with fire.
He said, for everyone shall be salted with that fire. Go ahead and read.
And every sacrifice shall be salted with salt.
And every sacrifice going to be salted with salt. Just like he told you, don't hold back on the salt on your offerings, on your meat offerings. Go ahead and read.
Salt is good.
And salt is good. Go ahead.
But if the salt have lost his saltiness, wherewith will ye season it?
But if a salt have lost its saltiness, what you going to use it for? Go ahead and read.
Have salt in yourselves.
Have salt in yourselves. Go ahead.
And have peace with another.
Y'all see how we talking about the word of God right here. And we talking about the peace that comes from the word of God. So now, let's go into Amos chapter 3. Amos 3, because the word of God was given to one set of people. And he only knew one set of people. I don't see how the world missed this. Well, I guess I can see. Because I lived a lot of years without knowing this myself. And I always had a Bible around me. Always. Just didn't go in it. That was the problem. Amos chapter 3, and let's start at verse 1, my brother. Amos 3 and 1. Amos 3, and let's start at the first verse. Amos 3 and verse 1. Go ahead and read.
Hear this word that the Lord has spoken against you, O children of Israel.
So it says right here, the Lord spoke against the children of Israel, the same ones he chose to be his priest to all nations. He said, I'm speaking against you. Go ahead and read.
Against the whole family which I brought up from the land of Egypt. Saying, you only have I known of all the families of the earth.
The Lord told Israel, you only have I known of all the families of the earth. Do y'all see how that is? God is saying right here, he don't know no other families on planet earth. He only knows Israel. Go ahead and read. Hold on. Let's let Latoya turn her phone off. We good, sister? Okay. Start at verse 2 over again.
You only have I known of all the families of the earth.
Now he's talking against Israel. He said, you only have I known of all the families of the earth. Go ahead and read.
Therefore, I will punish you for all your iniquities.
So he said, therefore, I'm going to punish you for everything you do wrong. Now, we all got family members and we all sit around playing cards with friends. And we all have had this conversation at one time or another. Man, my cousin did such and such, and he got 15 years. But that other person that don't have his brown paint job, he did the same thing and got 6 months probation. Haven't we had that conversation before? We all have. It's because you are the only one that God knows. You're the only one that he ever talked to, so you're the only one he can punish. Do y'all see that? Mm-hmm. He gave you the word to teach everybody else, and you didn't do that. So when somebody else do something wrong, he take their faults and come drop them right at your doorstep because you didn't teach them people, so you deal with it. Do y'all see that? We all see it. Y'all heard about the boy out there at Stanford a couple years ago, raped a girl, got 6 months probation. Huh?
Mm-hmm.
Then Lil Peanut up here in Brookstown do it. He gonna get 20 years in a state prison. Huh? The same crime. Less violent. But that's because the Lord said, hey, y'all the only ones I know, so you the only ones I can punish. Just like I always use this analogy, you take your children to the park. You got two kids. There's already eight kids at the park playing. Now when your two kids get over there with them other eight, now it's 10 of them. Then you sit down and look up and all 10 of them kids got rocks over on the other side of the park busting out car windows. How many of them 10 kids can you really go over there and punish? Just your two, because them the only ones you know, because they're yours. So when you look out your window today and you see that we the only people look like getting any kind of punishment, it's because we the only one that God knows. We are the ones he gave his laws, his statutes, and his judgment to. We are the one that was supposed to go teach everybody else. But we didn't want to do that. So now we get the head busting. And then we get, some of us get mad and want to blame other people just because the Lord used other people to whip your head with. Don't get mad at them people. You just line your life up with the Lord and understand where it's coming from. And he'll give you some room to breathe. But he says right here that he's going to punish you for everything. Just like when Ray Nagin, they said he did that thing down in New Orleans and did that thing with that money. Is he in prison right now, Brother Crew? But then you get this guy up in Chicago did the same thing. He got 1 year probation. A Polish guy. Huh? He took millions and got probation. Ray Nagin is sitting in jail because he got that brown paint job and he clearly is one of these children of the people that God knows because he don't know anybody else but us. And he sent us to do a job, and we fumbled the ball, and now we're paying for it.